Sitaogopa nikiwa na Yesu ndani yangu, amani tele iko moyoni. Nimechagua fungu jema kuwa na Yesu. Chagua na wewe mwenzangu, chelewa bado. Hata kama ndugu walitenge, marafiki waniache, sitaogopa nikiwa na Yesu ndani yangu, amani tele iko moyoni. Nimechagua fungu jema kuwa na Yesu. Chagua na wewe mwenzangu.
Personally, for me, this has been a great pleasure and opportunity to stand here and share. As a young man who grew up in this conference, a Central Kenya conference, never would I have thought that I would have an opportunity to stand here before men and women, of course, to share. And therefore, I take this one as an opportunity with a lot of humility and knowing that it is a great privilege. And therefore, I thank God for those of you who have organized for this, and even for those who will come so that we can share together. I'm going to ask the Lord to certainly speak through me to all of you, whatever He has prepared. This morning we are going to look at the topic, how to deal with discouragement. Let's pray. Eternal Father, we thank you so much because of your love, because of your kindness. We thank you for the gift of God. We thank you for the Holy Spirit of God who dwells in our hearts, who brings revival in our souls, who guides us and gives us wisdom. We thank you for the blood of Jesus Christ, that through His blood we have gained access to God, and you have been adopted into the family of God. Forgive our sins and cleanse us from our unrighteousness. This morning as we share together, may we learn lessons and principles from your word, because you've called us to live in you and to enjoy the joy that comes from you to our strength. Therefore, Lord, teach us from you, with me only as a blessing to we ask in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I know maybe some of you came and you saw what we have in here and thought we were going to have communion. And I actually saw some people trying to see what's going on. But one day, a story says that the devil decided to go out of business. And usually people say, man, the devil is going out of business. Can anyone say
that? Amen.
The devil decided he is done. And he's going to go out of business. And what happened is he decided to make a profit of everything that he has, the tools that he uses to do his work. And therefore he put a big banner and he said, I am going out of business. And I'm going to have a big sale in a big warehouse to sell all the tools that I've been using for my trade. And therefore I am asking for you to come and see what tool you can get and you can buy. And a lot of people are excited. A lot of people are happy because the devil was going out of business. And they came. It was in the evening when people came to that big warehouse and they started walking around to see all the wares that had been put out. They saw some tools. There was adultery. And some of them were very expensive. And someone would buy them. There was jealousy. And people would look at a tool that has been put there. And the devil had put a very high price. It was a very high price. And people would haggle and see. Oh, there was anger. And they would look at that. And someone would try to see if they can even sort their credit card. And they would get that. There was gossip. And people would look at that and say, wow, this is a good tool that the devil utilizes. And many other tools. But at the end of the table, towards the end, there was one small tool which was very rusty, which was very old, which looked as if it has been used very, very much. Now the problem was that it was the most expensive. The most expensive. And people thought that the devil had made yet another mistake. The devil was really trying to do one more call my business before going out of business. And people protested, Hakiyetu, they protested. And they came to the devil, they asked him, how is it that the oldest tool you have, the rustiest tool you have, the smallest that you have, is the most expensive? It does not even have a name. It just has a price tag, which is most expensive. The devil said, this is my most prized possession. It's the tool that I use very often and very much. It is called discouragement. It is a tool, and he continued to explain to them, through these tools, when I'm using these tools, people can see me coming from far, and they prepare for me. But with a tool of discouragement, they cannot see me coming. I just go slowly, and before they know it, I have arrested them, I have caught them, and then through discouragement, they start having excuses as to why things are not going the way they want them to go, and then through those excuses, they fall into sin. The story goes to say that after all the tools have been sold, this one tool, no one could afford it, and the devil did not go out of business. He continues to use that tool. It is the tool of discouragement. Friends, today we are talking about how to deal with discouragement. The New King James Bible Dictionary defines discouragement as the act of disheartening or depriving of courage, the act of deterring or dissuading from an undertaking, the act of depressing confidence. A person starts off very well with confidence, but discouragement comes in and depresses that confidence. Goes on to tell us that discouragement is that which destroys or reduces courage, that which depresses confidence or hope, that which deters or tends to deter from an undertaking or from the prosecution of anything. When the devil succeeds in using discouragement in your life, you become paralyzed. People are no longer motivated. People are no longer willing to do anything. People are not even able to do that which they've been called to do. When you look at discouragement, I want you to just look at this after a few things. Number one, in an attempt to understand discouragement, you need to know as leaders, as people who are working for God in the headquarters of this territory, that Satan uses negative people to bring about discouragement in your life. There are people who you're going to meet or you've met already, they'll just say one word. They may not even know why they say that one word. But the devil, who understands your psyche, who understands your background, who understands the struggle that you've gone through to be where you are in your walk with God, knows that that one word is going to trouble you for days on end. Satan uses the same people to criticize, to slander, and criticism is something that, you know, sometimes you do something good, it's not good enough. You do something bad, it's really bad. You make a mistake, there is no forgiveness. And criticism and slander. Slander is when just stories are started, you don't even know where they came from. And when we hear of this, we become discouraged. Discouragement also comes when Satan lies to us that we have to work so hard and we do not have to have balance. So the lack of balance leads to fatigue. And therefore, the man of God, the woman of God, goes through a situation of burnout. And when you're burning out, all your defenses are down, and the devil easily leads you to discouragement. There is wisdom in saying no to some things. Amen.
Amen.
There is wisdom in planning your work. Because even Jesus did not finish this work. He, the Son of God, did not finish it. And you too will not finish it. Do only that which you can do and pace yourself. There's also idealistic thinking and having unrealistic expectations. And this happens when many times we are motivated by pride or ambition and we want to do something so maybe we can leave a legacy or maybe people can see that we can do. Sister White talks to us in the Savages and says, if we plan according to our own ideas, the Lord will leave us to our own mistakes. But if you plan according to the word of God, He will lead us to have realistic plans, realistic expectations, so that we can be able to glorify Him. Also, discouragement happens when we experience disappointment with God. No, it's not when God disappoints us, because He cannot. It's when you experience disappointment with God. We started off with maybe some expectations, or maybe we had some prayers that have not been answered. Or maybe something is going on, and then you think, or you are persuaded by the enemy that God has forsaken you, and he is not going to come through for you. My friends, discouragement is something that happens to all of us. As long as you're a human being in this world, you are going to be discouraged, or you have been discouraged, or you are discouraged this morning. If that is so, I want to let you know that you're in good company. People of God throughout the ages have been discouraged. King David was troubled, and he battled with despair. Actually, Christian psychologists think that David was having some really, really serious mental health struggles, because one time, you know, he's writing a psalm of joy and what God has done and how he's going to glory in God. And then the next psalm, he's writing about how depressed and how downcast he is. You can see Psalm 42. Why are you downcast, O my soul? Why is so disturbed within me? We have a person like Elijah, who is another one who was actually struggling with clinical depression to the point of becoming suicidal. If Elijah was walking on earth today, he would have been committed. This is not a person who would be allowed to walk the streets up and down, because at any given moment, he will commit suicide after God had come in and showed himself mighty on his behalf. The next thing we see is Elijah saying to God, I have had enough. Take my life. I am not better than my ancestors. No one had asked him whether he was better than anyone. But when you start comparing yourself to people, when you start setting yourself up with unrealistic expectation, the devil opens a door and he comes in. How about Moses, the man of God? After God had given him the commandments and he saw that the people were sinning and he felt betrayed by his own people, he says to God, but now please forgive their sin, but if not, then blot me out of the book you have written. Even Moses, the friend of God, the servant of God, suffered so much discouragement to the point of being disappointed and depressed. And he's telling God, I am not ready to come and live in heaven. This was not love. This was discouragement. Sometimes you lift that up and say, he was a great leader who loved his people and he would do anything for his people. No, this was discouragement. This was depression. How about Job? Job, we just finished reading his lesson towards the end of 2016. And Job, you know, there are so many times he talks about his discouraging experience. He suffered through great loss. He was devastated. He had physical illness to the point where even his wife tells him, curse God and die. And you read through all those scriptures that you find a man who is truly and fully discouraged. How about Jeremiah? Jeremiah is a man who wrote a whole book called Lamentations. When people are writing good books, he sits down and he writes a book called Mambolezo. He was a man who was depressed from the word get-go. From chapter 1, you see him telling God, I can't do this. And God is trying to encourage him. He wrestled with great loneliness, feelings of defeat, and insecurity. He's also known as the weeping prophet. How about Jonah? Another one. Another one who should not be allowed to be walking around. He's a man who was very suicidal. At one point he tells God, now, O Lord, take away my life, for it is better for me to die than to live. This is a man who did a one-man TMI. One-man TMI. He goes through the whole city. He preaches in 3 days, and the whole city is converted. They actually declare a fast. And the fast included animals. And everybody is converted. Now, Jonah, instead of taking a wonderful mission report back to this home conference, he sits down and he's depressed because people have come to God. You see, many times, Mr. Kombe, you may think that all of you, just because you're the same committee, you're working towards the same goals. It may not be the same. This man is used by God, but he was working on his own agenda. And his sermon was a one-statement sermon. Yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be destroyed. And even then, God used him. The man is so depressed to the point of becoming suicidal. How about Jesus Christ? Jesus himself, he says in Mark 14, he is deeply grieved to the point of death. The point that I'm trying to bring here is that being discouraged or even coming to the verge of depression is universal, is something that we all deal with, especially as leaders. You are under target by the devil to discourage you. I also suspect that that Joshua was dealing with discouragement, especially when he saw the shoes that he was going to fill. You read chapter 1 of the book of Joshua, and he's being told of what he is supposed to do when he's inheriting the leadership role of Moses. And time again, he's being told, now, therefore, be of good courage, be of strong, be of good courage. You know, there's no way God would tell him to be of good courage if he was courageous. There's no way God would tell him to be strong if he was strong. The man had issues. Joshua, the man, he had issues. All right? And that's why throughout scripture, we see words like, do not be discouraged, do not be afraid, be of good courage, do not fear. I want us to focus on what Paul writes in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 8 through 10. And here, Paul talks about his experience. And he says, we are hard-pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body. And here Paul uses four Greek verbs that are very important for us to look at this morning. He uses the word hard-pressed, and here he's using gladiatorial language. And what he's trying to paint is when gladiators are fighting, and two of them are going at each other, one of them who is stronger pushes one almost to the point of being pushed to the corner, and this weak gladiator has no any other way out. He's being pinned to that corner, and the next thing that they're going to do is to wait for the emperor to either give the thumbs up sign or the thumbs down sign. When the emperor gives thumbs up, the man is to be spared. When he gives thumbs down, the man is to be killed. And therefore says, we are hard pressed on every side. We are being pushed to the corner. Everything is coming at one time, pushing us to the point of giving up. Then he says, we are perplexed. And here, what he's talking about is coming to the point of not knowing what to do. That is what that verb is showing us in the Greek. Coming to the point of what, not knowing what to do. You see, many times, as a leader, you come to a point where you know that you don't know what to do. Suddenly, I've come through, you know, most of those situations, even in our church when you're leading, and you know the situation has arisen, and you don't know what you're supposed to do. But now, leadership lessons teach you that when you come to that place, you're not supposed to show people that you don't know what you're doing. But what that does, it only adds to stress. But what the Word of God is telling us, there is wisdom in just telling people, my pastor, my elder, me too, I don't know how we should go about this thing. Let us pray about it. Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. Not to pretend, this is what, and then you just talk, and some people who are wiser than you, some people who have walked with God longer than you, they just look at you and say, he really doesn't know what he's talking about. He has no idea what he's talking about. There's wisdom in just saying, you know what, I'm perplexed. This one, I don't know how to handle this, but God knows how to handle this. Let us approach him in prayer. I guess at some point he will show us how to handle us. Persecuted. He's talking about being hunted down like an animal, being chased up and down. And when he was writing to these believers, they truly understood what it meant to be chased up and down like an animal. You're being chased, they're trying to hide, you're being chased, and they're trying to get you, and you have nowhere to go. And then he talks about being struck down. And being struck down, he's actually talking about being physically beaten. Being physically beaten in the body, your body is bearing bruises. But at the same time, when he's talking about what he's going through, he also adds some things which bring about joy. If there's negativity on one side, there's something positive. Yes, we have been hard-pressed. Everything is coming together to press us. But by the grace of God, we are not yet crushed. Hallelujah. Amen. We are perplexed. We don't know what to do. I actually have no idea on how to approach this issue, but not in despair. Hallelujah. Because there's a God who knows what to do. I have been persecuted. I'm being chased. The devil seems, like Pastor Kombe said yesterday, the devil seems to have called even the devils who went on vacation, who are on leave, they've now been called together, and they seem to be working in league, in tandem, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed. Paul seemed to know what he was talking about in the book of 2 Corinthians. He's talking about his experiences, and he says five times he has received 39 lashes. He has been shipwrecked three times. He has spent 24 hours in the sea floating around. He has faced danger from water, from robbers, from countrymen, from Gentiles. But throughout his experiences, Paul remains to be of good courage. I do not see any times in the Pauline epistles where Paul seems to have lost his courage, where Paul seems to be discouraged. How does Paul handle this? I'd like to share with you just 3 points how we can see what Paul was able to do to handle discouragement. Number one, invite Christ into your discouraging experience. Here, Paul writes, after talking about how hard-pressed they have been, how complex they are, how persecuted and struck down they've been, he adds in verse 10, always carrying about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body. Here, what Paul is saying is that even in the midst of my discouraging experience, I am not willing to go through it alone. Because what the devil wants us to do when he attacks the mind and he removes the joy of God in our minds, he makes us to think that even God has forsaken us. When you go through your discouraging experience, when you have that discouraging moment, do not allow yourself to go through it alone, because you are incapable of doing so. As a matter of fact, that is the time to invite Christ to walk with you through the discouraging experience. Not only that, that is the time to ensure that you are doing your due diligence. You are not forsaking your spiritual disciplines. You are still waking up early in the morning to pray. You are still reading the Word of God. You are still feeding from the Spirit of prophecy. You are still continuing with the way things were before you hit your discouraging experience. That's why Paul is saying to us, I affirm by the boasting in you which I have in Christ Jesus, our Lord, I die daily. With this with him, Paul would confidently face any discouraging experience and not lose his courage. What the devil would want us to do is that when he has brought that discouraging experience in our lives, we forsake our prayer. We forsake the coming of together. We forsake our singing. We forsake everything. And we want to just stay at home, sleep under the blanket, sleep under the covers. I am so discouraged. Why is God doing this to me? Why has God allowed all this to me, to be happening? And then as that continues, we will become more and more discouraged. Sister White has exhausted us. It says that Joseph and Mary had stayed their minds upon God by meditation and prayer. They would have realized the sacredness of their trust and will not have lost sight of Jesus. This is why discouragement so often exists among the professed followers of Christ. Joseph and Mary, they were not praying. And this is during the Feast of Passover. For a whole 1 week, people had gathered. It was a feast of thanksgiving and sacrifices and worship. But these guys, they were not praying. They were not meditating. They were actually spending their time talking to other people and just wasting time. And that's why we are told this is why discouragement so often exists among the professed followers of Christ. If you are not faithful in your morning time with Christ, if you have not been meeting Christ in your prayer closet, if you have not been spending time hearing from God through his word, through spiritual prophecy, you are being prepared, you are being set up by the devil for discouraging experience. He will take you far away from God, and when you are alone by yourself, he will deal with you. Remember, just remember this, discouragement is nothing but spiritual warfare. And you cannot handle this by yourself. You have to invite Christ into your discouraging experience. I want to share with you the second point. Embrace a new perspective of your discouraging experience. When you walk with God and you invite Christ into a discouraging experience, what he does, he starts to give you a new perspective as to how this discouraging experience fits into the overall picture of what he has for your life. The theologian A.W. Tozer spoke and wrote and said, God cannot use someone powerfully until he has hurt him painfully. It won't happen. If you have not gone through a painful, discouraging experience, it is impossible for God to use you powerfully. As a matter of fact, your greatest ministry will come out of your greatest disappointment, your greatest hurts. Rick Warren, the pastor of Saddleback, actually has a requirement for any pastor who is wanting to join the pastoral staff. He has to answer the question, have you ever gone through a discouraging, painful experience? And if the answer is no, then he tells them, you are not ready to serve. The discouraging experience, the painful experience that you went through or you're going through, when you walk with God, God will show you how it fits into the overall picture that he has for you. Because God has a way of changing the way we think and the way we look at things. And that's why Paul says to us, be transformed by the renewing of your mind so that you may prove what that is good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. When we allow God into our discouraging situation, embarrassing, hurting situation, God and only God has a way, it's a miraculous way to turn that thing that was so terrible, that is so bad, for his glory. And only God can do that. And that's how we are able to join with Joseph to say, you meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. I was in prison for 13 years, going from prison to prison, sold as a slave, accused of issues that I would not even have thought of. And even when I served and I asked this butler to remember me, he forgot me for 2 years. God gave Joseph a new perspective, and he was able to tell his brothers, he meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. When we turn to God and we embrace a new perspective, as Paul, we see the following 5 things. Number one, we see a conviction. Paul had a conviction that spiritual power flows to us when we suffer. And this is why he was able to write in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, 9 through 10, when he's talking about the thorn in the flesh, God told him, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, most gladly, I would rather boast in my infirmities that the power of Christ may rest upon me. He understood that spiritual power flows to us when we suffer, but only when we allow Christ into our discouraging situation. He also had a conviction that we do encounter Christ when we suffer. We encounter him in our suffering. Philippians 3 verse 10 says that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death, if by any means I may attain to the resurrection from the dead. He also had a conviction, which is true, that Christ is glorified when we suffer. It is for his glory. And therefore, the discouraging experience, even the people that I shared with before the beginning of this morning devotion, all the saints of old who suffered, God was glorified in their suffering, and that's why we learn from them today. Writes in Philippians 1:20 through 21, according to my earnest expectation and hope, that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but with all boldness as always, so now also Christ will be magnified in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is death, to die is gain. He also had a conviction that well, the work of Christ is complete when we suffer, Colossians 1:24, where he's talking about all this is happening for the sake of his body, which is the church. And the final conviction, the fifth one, is that we qualify for rewards when we suffer. And this is where he writes and says that he does not want to be disqualified after he has preached to many. He does not want to be disqualified. And therefore, what does he do? He disciplines his body and brings it to subjection. That time of disciplining the body happens through our suffering, happens through our discouraging experience. And there's something good to be gained from that. And this is why Paul and Silas, when they were in that prison, they were able to embrace a new perspective. They knew that Christ was with them. If it were up to today's psychologists, humanistic thinkers, they would just tell them, this is the way you deal with stress. Just think of a beautiful time where you were in a beautiful place, where you were in a sunny place in Mombasa, and there was no stress in your life, and you were enjoying it, and there was no worry, and everything was fine. Just think about that time, and go to that place in your mind, and everything will be fine. My friends, Even if you do that, at the end of the day, you realize you're still in jail and you're tied down and you're being persecuted, and tomorrow you're probably going to be killed. But when they invited Christ into their situation, and when Christ gave them a new perspective, they were able to understand that even if they are going to die, they are going to go down singing. Hallelujah. They are going to go down praising Him. And when God came through, even the God Himself, who was getting ready to kill Himself, who was getting ready to commit suicide, the God now is the one dealing with discouragement. Paul says to him, "Do not do it. We are all here." And he ended up asking for baptism. The last point that I want to share with you after sharing these two, that you need to invite Christ into a discouraging experience, because discouragement is spiritual warfare, and that you need to ask Christ to help you and to allow you to embrace a new perspective of what you're going through. The number three is that stand and fight, but do not fight alone. Connect with the body of believers.
Amen.
Don't run away from discouragement. Stand and fight. Don't run away from that situation. Stand and fight. You realize this is the devil who is coming, I'm ready for you. You are defeated, but you're in denial. God has already won the victory, you do not seem to accept it. I'm going to stand and I'm going to fight, but I'm not going to fight alone. Connect with the body of believers. When people are discouraged, usually what happens is that they withdraw. They don't want to talk to anyone. A person who used to be happy is now very sad. A person who was bubbly is now very sad. They don't want to talk. They're quiet. When you read Steps to Christ, it talks about how it is impossible to be a sad Christian. That cannot be possible. You cannot be a Christian and sad. Those two cannot be happening at the same time. Because the joy of the Lord is our strength. And therefore, people withdraw. They don't want to mingle with people. They just want to be left alone. They used to come to this church, they move to another church. Or even when you meet them in the evening, where did you go to which church did you go? Oh, I went to church number B. Then you meet people who were in church number B, and they tell you, and they ask you, oh, where did you go to? Google, you didn't go to church, you're just staying at home, you're just withdrawing, you don't want anything to do with anybody. What the devil wants to do, he knows very well that the sheep that has been separated from others is the sheep that is easily defeated. And therefore, that's why we are saying, fight, stand and fight, but do not fight alone, connect with the body of believers. And therefore, people choose to withdraw, and other people choose not to disclose what is going on. And people go around just pretending as if everything is okay. You know you're suffering, you know things are not fine, but you don't want to share with anyone. I'm going to die alone. I'm going to die with my issues. But there is wisdom in putting aside somebody and just saying, my pastor, this is what I'm going through. Would you pray with me? Would you pray with me? Would you please add that issue into your prayer request? And God is able to hear and answer that prayer. We started by defining what discouragement is. It's the act of disheartening or depriving of courage. Courage is taken away. And this courage, when it's taken away, what it ends up doing is it depresses confidence. But in Scripture, the Church of God is being called to do many things. To witness, to evangelize, to reach out, to baptize. Yes, we've been called to do that. But none of that is as important as the work of encouraging others. Let me say that again. We've been called to evangelize the Church of God, to witness, to baptize in the Great Commission, but none of that is as important as the work of encouraging others. Because when someone has lost their courage, they're not going to witness. When someone is discouraged, they're not going to evangelize. And as a matter of fact, if someone is coming to evangelize to me, and they're so depressed, they're so downcast, and they're telling me Jesus is coming, and they're so depressed, and please come join our church, and I'm asking to join your church to become like you, I don't want to do that. I am okay where I am. We sing, tunasifu, tunaruka, tunapiga drum. We are happy. You and your discouragement stay where you are. And the Bible talks to us about that in many verses. Hebrews 10, verse 25 says, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another. Hallelujah. And that is why there's wisdom. Every single day, do not allow a day to go by without encouraging someone. You do not know what people are going through. Just a quick text. My friend, I'm praying for you. The Lord is with you. I know how sometimes during my discouraging experience, just a simple text or a simple phone call or even a simple ministry from a brother or a sister has always lifted me up. The Word of God is calling us to do that, even when we are meeting together, to do so, to encourage one another. Hebrews 3, verse 13. But encourage one another daily, as long as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. And as leaders here, you have pastors in the front line. It feels good when they get even a simple text message. My pastor, we are praying for you. In the family. I know suddenly I feel good when my leaders in the conference just call to check on me and say, just know that you're praying for me. You feel stupid. You have no idea how far that can take somebody. Because you may not know what they were going through. I know, yes, it's busy and you have other things, administrative duties, which are very important also. But you do have troops in the front line. And they're wounded, they're injured. And they're suffering, they're going through a lot. Just a good phone. You see, sometimes, you have people, the moment they receive a phone call coming from the conference, now they wonder, what did I do now? What sin have I committed? What are the elders saying about me? But it needs to come to the point where they actually look forward to those text messages. The youth leaders know we have a good pastor, Pastor Mutugi. He always calls to check on me, to encourage me, to pray with me. And your work becomes easier because you have troops who are encouraged. You have troops who have been given strength, who have been infused with courage because of you encouraging them. I'm going to share with you the very last one here that Pastor Solomon inspired the letter. It says, therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you're doing. The work of encouraging one another is the work that we've been called to do as a church. A story is told about an old missionary couple that had been working in Africa for years. And the time came for them to return to New York City to retire. It just so happened that they had no pension, their health was broken, they were defeated, they were discouraged, they were afraid, even the work that they had done was not good enough, and they were just coming back home to retire. When they got into the ship that was sailing to the U.S., they discovered that they had been booked into the same ship as President Roosevelt, who was returning from Africa from one of his big game hunting expeditions. He was a man who used to love to hunt. And when this old missionary couple got in, no one paid any much attention to them. And they watched the fanfare as people acknowledged the president into the ship. And as they continued to sail, everybody was happy that the president and his wife, they were there, but no one took any notice on these poor, old, tired, discouraged missionaries. When they moved, when they actually got to New York City, there was a big celebration that was going on. There was the mayor, the governor, and a big band waiting to greet the president. The dignitaries were there. And the wife of this missionary looked at her husband and said, something is wrong. We are coming back from doing God's work. We've been preaching, we've used all our time to serve God. But here we are, a man who's coming back from killing lions is getting all this recognition. Something has to be wrong. Where is God in all this? And as they were waiting for the president to come in, there was a big man, and he was, all the other unimportant people are told, you go out through that back door so the president can come, on the red carpet. And they went through the back door, and they went home. When they went home, they were very, very discouraged. The man was very discouraged, and he said that his spirit was broken. And he said, I can't take this anymore. God is not treating us fairly. I want to go and see if I can spend some time with God to see whether God can explain what's going on. After a few minutes in prayer, he came back out. His face was beaming. And he said to his wife, I spent some time with God, and I've shared with him our discouragement and why things seem to be upside down. Why someone who is coming from killing animals is getting recognition, and us who have come from preaching and doing God's work, no one seems to care for us. We are sick, we are old, we are afraid, we are discouraged. No one is doing anything to us. And he said, it's as if though God touched my shoulder and said to me, my son, you're not home yet. You are not home yet. When the time comes for you to come home, you will get all of that. Hallelujah, somebody.
Amen.
Therefore, keep on working for God. Even when you're discouraged, keep on working for God. Invite Him to a discouraging experience. Understand this is warfare. Understand that you're the target. Ask God to help you embrace a new perspective. He will let you see how this fits into the overall picture of what He's doing in your life. And when that time comes, when you have to fight, stand and fight, but do not fight alone. Connect with the body of believers. They are going to encourage you, even as you have been an encouragement to them. Let's pray. We thank you, dear Jesus. We thank you for the fact that we've seen, even through your word, that yes, indeed, discouragement is a portion. And many times we are under the target of the enemy. He discourages us through so many things. Our situations at home, our situations in the office, our situation even in your work can be discouraging. But Lord, through your word, we learned that even in those discouraging moments, just like Paul, we can stand firm and know that with you, you're going to enable us to have a new perspective, new ways, a new perspective. And even you're going to give us courage to stand and fight as we connect with the body of Christ. I pray especially for all these children who work here in this conference office. Bless them indeed. For those who are discouraged, Lord, I pray that you give them courage. Strengthen them, O God. And allow them to see how this fits into the overall picture, the big picture that you have for them. For those who are not discouraged, Lord, I pray that you give them strength, give them new perspective, fortify their minds, so that even when the time comes when the devil try to discourage them, let them be able to stand firm and stand tall because they walk with you. For all of us, Lord, we pray that you keep us faithful. Keep us preparing us for your coming kingdom, where we are going to come and live with you in a place where there will be no sorrow, no discouragement, no depression. We thank you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Sitaogopa, nikiwa na Yesu ndani yangu amani tele iko moyoni. Nimechagua fungu jema.